keynote session, and then after that we'll have our student awards. And I think the keynote session, I won't give away too much, but I think it's going to touch on some of those themes, but also get into another of our main themes, which is civic, creative, commercial, thinking about how those pieces interact in and through media architecture. So I'm not going to say much more. I think we have an expert here to tell us more about that. But to introduce that expert, we have another expert. We have Mei Chu here. Mei is one of the executive committee members for the Biennale. And she teaches at the Mel Hoppenheim School of Cinema in the Department of Art History. Her research focuses on interactive and immersive technologies in diverse museum and exhibit spaces across Canada, and how these technologies facilitate the material practice of nation and cultural citizenship. So over to you, Mei, to introduce the keynote.
Thanks so much, Dave. Hi, everyone. I'm joining you today from Georgiage, Montreal, the unceded lands of the Ganyangehaga Nation. And it's my deep pleasure to introduce mab23's first keynote speaker, Sherry Dobbin. Sherry Dobbin is a cultural and placemaking advisor with over 35 years experience in leading cultural organizations and curating for the public realm across four continents. From 2017 to 2022, she served as managing and cultural director at Future City UK, a global placemaking and public art commissioning agency based in London, where she consulted for developers, cities, and business improvement districts to establish permanent and programmatic cultural sustainability for place identity. Here, she brokered partnerships for the Centre Pompidou, the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, and the Museum of London to create new cultural institution co-location models and built environment projects. Prior to Future City, Sherry served as director of Times Square Arts and creative director for Times Square Alliance from 2012 to 2016, where she founded Midnight Moment, the world's largest and longest running digital art exhibition, shown on the electronic billboards every night since 2012. Here, she produced over 150 projects, including 94 curator partnerships with cultural institutions, commercial galleries, and architecture and design associations. Before this, she was director of Robert Wilson's Experimental Performance Center, the Watermill Center, and project director of arts-led regeneration initiatives throughout London and England. So this is just a truncated bio in the interest of time. For more, you can always head over to sherrydobbin.com. But for now, please help me extend a very warm welcome to Sherry. So how this hour will unfold is we'll watch Sherry's recorded keynote, The Media Triangle, Civic, Commerce, Creative, and then Sherry will join us live for a discussion afterwards. And just in case there are tech difficulties, we might have to switch between Sherry and my computer for the recorded keynote.
Thank you so much. It's a really great opportunity to give this keynote. So I'm going to kick off with the video version of myself. And like Mei said, you know, if the Wi-Fi gods go against us, then we've got a backup plan. So just give me one moment to get ready. And enjoy the show. It's about 25 minutes, so we've left quite a bit of time where we can get into questions and dialogue. Feel this might be the thing that most people will want. Okay, enjoy.
Hello, I'm here to talk to you about that three-legged stool, the media triangle, how civic, commerce, and creative work together in our media architecture scenarios. I'm going to talk to you in length about a case study in New York City with the Midnight Moment program that I had founded. But before I get started and go through a series of examples, I want to acknowledge the current director, Gene Cooney, who's been doing a brilliant job and celebrated the 10th year anniversary with an entire season of female artists recognizing the women who had been the pioneers in the space for so long. So globally, purpose-built or appropriated media surfaces are now receiving and seeking artist creativity more regularly for a variety of agendas. For example, there's the Noor Festival in Riyadh. The Hamburg Philharmonie has incorporated it into its external identity. Circa is a program that is multi-continent, multi-screen presentation, and also living simultaneously online. And in Hong Kong, the Open Sky Gallery, which was created by a fellow juror, Maurice Vignon, has been going and playing with the exceptional vertical space for 10 years or so now. But let's not pretend. The reality is, media architecture has a very complex ownership. There are architects and developers and landlords and tenants and business improvement districts or precincts, local government, cultural institutions, the public, programs, community interests, and artists, all working to own these spaces. We also have multiple happenings that are targeted for the individual or personal experience. They might be celebrating something area specific. They may be citywide or even global. And we add an interface with many screens through our phones, through VR headsets, and multiple sizes. We also need to add in the different legislation, regulations, and restrictions in relationship to these surfaces, different in every city, every state, every country, every continent. And let's not forget that the technology sector has its own interests and hopes of what they want to explore and what they consider to be art. So all of this leads to a very complex idea of the city as an exhibition space, which ultimately brings us into a next era of public art. And so what is that structure that is just enough and not too much to plan for the unexpected? And how do we define successful public art? I decided to seek definitions for public art from a more traditional context, but nonetheless to see what the common denominators were. New York City's Percent for Art program says that site-specific and engaging a variety of media. The author and publisher Tom Finkelpearl has said, well, if you turn your back to it, if the audience is engaged, then it works. Claire Dougherty, who was the founder of Situations in Bristol in the UK, talks about aesthetic integrity, which means that we have to be able to distinguish critically successful public artworks from other activities, and they need to be ones that generate new forms of critical dialogue or transformation. Justine Simons, our deputy mayor for creative industries in London, successful artworks being visually interesting, having something relevant to say, and then what do they have to say to their space and the rest of the world? So let's talk about this ecosystem that we need, I propose, for media architecture. We need all of them invested, we need all of them sharing, and we need all of them risk. That risk is mitigated or supported by finding, as you can see in this diagram, that shared sweet spot, a place in which you have shared objectives that overlap, in which case everybody can be selfish. But it also enables the percentage or the financial investment that can morph and adjust over time. And it will flex in different ways where different partners may put in different amounts. So the first step that we need to agree with this media intervention is to think about what it is you want to achieve. So if you want to make a statement or a commitment, you might be looking at something that is permanent. If you are trying to encourage dialogue and curiosity, you probably need something temporary or in a series. And if you need instant energy excitement, think about a pop-up and not overstructuring it. When I was the chair of the Urban Art Forum for the Urban Land Institute in the UK, we developed a publication called Including Culture in Development. And this was a six-step process, which you can always go back to. And at any point, you can always go back to the first step. This works for any type of art, but it does also apply to this very complex landscape. So first, agree what your vision of success is. Then establish the benchmarks and the true measurements you're going to use to see if you got there. Select the cultural engagement that I just referred to on the previous slide. Then build an inventory of resources. This may be people or hours or particular space or security crews or permits. Whatever it is, don't judge it, just inventory them. Then you can look at how you create the strategic opportunity and you hire the cultural professionals. Also, agree that cultural brief. And don't forget that you will always, always be collaborating with unexpected entities. It might be the weather, it might be transportation, it might be different people who include themselves in the experience. But the reality is public space is always going to have an unpredictable collage. So let's talk about Times Square. And in order to understand the midnight moment, I need to give you a little bit of context about Times Square. Now, every day, over 380,000 international visitors, American tourists, and New York City residents and workers cross these asymmetrical pedestrian plazas under all of these strobing electronic signs. It also is a very large cultural district, home to Broadway theater. It also happens to be a commercial epicenter of global retail and finance. But you know, in the late 1970s and the early 1980s, Times Square represented the bankrupt and broken New York City. It was notorious for the proliferation of porn shows, peep shows, kung fu movie houses, and lots of prostitution. The economic development and the city incentives to businesses soon encouraged investment in the area, and the city worked to clear out the crime. New businesses boomed, rents soared, and tourists began to flood these thoroughfares. As a result, the majority of artists and other local residents and businesses were eventually relocated in exchange for these high commercial tenants, including the internationally branded retailers and restaurants. It was after the success of these red steps, which were the winner of a theater ticket booth design competition, that the Times Square Alliance decided that it wanted to create a cultural program that could bring back a bit of the long-standing, edgy, creative, flashy quirkiness. So let me talk to you about my inheritance in 2012 when I stepped into the role of founding Times Square Arts. The 2 years previously, in 2010, the Alliance had initiated a public art program that wanted to counterbalance the commercial visual cacophony. It was a democratic, non-curated approach that was taken to rely upon very widely distributed open calls, so that the bid was seen to be supporting the presentation of arts, but not curating them. There was an impressive arts advisory committee that also included Times Square Alliance board members, representatives then from Department of Transportation, Public Art Commission, New York City Parks. It was established to inform the direction, and then a subset became a selection committee to choose these proposals from the open call. But the program was vulnerable because with the uncertainty of how the arbitrary proposals would form a sense of program, there was a question about how would this actually deliver against the key district objectives? How is it going to make a difference in local residents' perception of place? How would it differ from the commercial marketing events that we'll be putting on? And what you may not know is that New Yorkers' favorite sport is to love to hate Times Square. And there was a constant claim that it had lost its authenticity of place. My claim was that the Times Square Alliance had to set firsts, take risks, and then generously share a precedence that would indirectly encourage other cities to be bolder. With almost 400,000 people coming per day, we could take the risk of trying things that other cities couldn't without a concern about people not coming to the area. My vision of success was to make Times Square New York City's cultural hub, to geographically and soulfully regain its role as a city center. We needed visitors who were seeking spectacle and authenticity We needed to support businesses attracting world-class talent to headquarter there. It was necessary to raise the ambition of Cultural Sense of Program to showcase the city's cultural infrastructure through these institutional partnerships. It was this way that we could also gain loyalty from the jaded New Yorker. I had come to this role not from urban design or from a placemaking background, but actually from 20 years of professional experience working in the arts across all forms. And it was, and it still is, very rare to have a dedicated full-time and senior level cultural professional within a bid. What this meant was that I could sit as a part of the senior management team under the direct dialogue with the president of the Alliance. I was able to collaborate then with the vice presidents of policy planning, research and economic development, operations and security, events marketing, finance, human resources, communications, and sponsor development. I learned that our tourists were visitors representing well-educated, high to medium income. And this helped me to redefine the tourist as an adventurer who sought surprise, who left their home, who spent an amount of money to bring their families to this place. Our pedestrian counting cameras also taught me the patterns of behavior according to the times of day on each of these plazas. So being embedded within a bid gave me an incredible amount of exposure to what are the exceptional issues, a global place that is a gathering spot for important political and social protests, as well as capitalistic activity. I presented at the board meetings, up to 55 board members representing some of the largest developers and property leasers, financial and legal firms, 25% of the hospitality industry in New York City, as well as entertainment services and theaters and churches, and the major transportation authorities. I was present at the executive committee of 8 of New York City's most influential CEOs that took place in the New York Times headquarters every 6 weeks. It was listening to the challenges of the district that became my creative inspiration and direction. I sought general cultural collaborations that would also positively counter the negative perceptions or challenges about the place. Giving artists and curators a problem was actually providing them with the intrigue and dramatic tension that was so attractive to them. The problem, thus, became the greatest advantage. At the same time that I came into position, I needed to start with the impossible. And this is the birth of the Midnight Moment. The billboards, the electronic billboards, are the most unique aspect of Times Square's authenticity. They are the greatest symbol for the place for over 100 years. And while public art organizations, Creative Time, Public Art Fund, and Performa have run programs or projects on one screen at a time, there had never been a consistent commitment across multiple screens to create what they call in the industry a domination event. But, you know, requesting free time on the individually owned and operated billboards that are very expensive to run and maintain and replace required some exceptional content, time, and some form of return on investment. There are property owners, screen owners, subcontractors who sell the advertising. All of these individuals are competitors who needed to be collaborators. We partnered with the nonprofit entity Times Square Advertising Coalition to have one body representing the independent billboard owners so that we established a producing partnership whereby TSEC presents and Times Square Arts curates. Previously, curators had presented the information that were very familiar to them in their field, but they were almost incomprehensible to the billboard owners. I needed to recognize how the screens were part of the architecture and therefore part of the scenography, and that Midnight Moment needed to contrast the typical screening styles and make the viewers, performers, at the center of the scene. The sign holders needed to understand what advantages this could bring them. And part of the return on investment was the incredible documentation that is taken and shared, where there's actually non-branded content that they can put into their sales and promotional materials. And the attraction opened up a litany of different press that never would have been interested in the screens otherwise. The curation needed to be a combination of aesthetic diversity, and partnering curators were linked to major moments in the city or major exhibitions so that we could draw their networks, audiences, press contacts, and expand the artistic network. We became, in essence, their greatest outreach location so that they could reach new audiences and we could draw attention. And it's actually Midnight Moment that facilitated Times Square Art's first big tipping moment, the point where people could see the power of art taking place in Times Square. I like to think that we stopped the world from ending on 12/12/12, which is when Nostradamus had claimed that it would be coming to a halt, by screening Yoko Ono's Imagine Peace, with her permission to have the ordinary visitors sing John Lennon's song Imagine together on the iconic red steps. We started 11:57, continuing the song through till midnight and ensuring that the world continued. From this 3-minute action, we gained over 600,000 press impressions from 63 countries. The action then began to garner trust from the board, the billboard stakeholders, the staff, and the creative community, all who have been circumspect about the power of the media triangle. Rather than commission work to reflect holidays, we sourced existing work that indirectly celebrated that time. For example, Alex Prager's Applause in 2016 is a video portrait of people in the auditorium clapping. This corresponded to June, the month of the Tony Awards celebrating Broadway. For the February celebration of Valentine's Day, we commissioned Tracy Emin to create I Promise to Love You through an animation of her neon sculptures that reflected love messages. We developed live actions on the plaza that drew attention and worked around our crazy late night sound restrictions. We pitched the concept of the silent disco headphones to create these immersive fine art moments for a general audience. We held a special concert of Ryoji Ikeda's Test Pattern Times Square in 2014, with he doing a live mix to accompany the intense binary code strobing of his visuals. And then employed this same technology to create a silent orchestra where instruments were electronically plugged in and Jarek Bischoff's video and composition Cistern was shown on the screens. The people with the headphones were able to see the individual in the orchestra, see him on the screen at the same time. And those who were walking past got to see this beautiful choreography of what it looks like when an orchestra plays together. Laurie Anderson was able to perform a solo live concert for dogs on the Red Step, which was alongside her film, Heart of a Dog. She was able to celebrate to the first responders of 9/11, all of those dogs who had gone into the rubble, and be able to share one of the quirkiest downtown artists in the heart of Midtown. With Rashad Newsom, we actually created a film shoot, two film shoots, to platform marginalized LGBTQA+ rap artists to perform with his The Conductor. Later, Rashad has created another piece working with Black Voguers in his piece, Black Magic. But the way that we could continue to attract our media triangle was to ensure that we did come up with guidance and a framework. You have to structure it. We developed a vision that was specific to this place. Times Square Arts collaborates with contemporary artists to experiment and engage with one of the world's most iconic urban places. We wanted to have that commitment solidified that there would be room to experiment while also engaging the public. Underpinning that vision are the core values. These are the things that give a sense of what we were looking for, but also served as criteria to objectively select what works were best. We looked at how they were collaborative. either in their making or in the way that they considered collaborating with the space. Like Times Square, they needed to be boundary pushing. The work always needed to be responsive to this particular place. And because Times Square is open 24/7, we needed to be transparent about how work was created. And then conversational. We weren't looking for statements. We were looking for pieces that engaged an audience in conversation. So in 1980, Jane Dickson saw the opportunity to invite fellow artists to create digital content in place of vacant advertising slots on the One Times Square Spectacular. The sign holder saw the advantage of keeping the spectacular alive and surprising. The artist could command valuable real estate and reach a broad general public. And the civic cultural appreciated an advertising break. So now in 2023, 43 years on, there have been many single screen efforts, and the midnight moment has just turned 11. The parallel between the 1980s and 2023 is this media triangle. It is where the civic, the commerce, and the creative meet. I want to leave you with six key messages. These are all appropriate to the scale, the programs, and the places. Because in the 153 projects that I did in 5 years, what most people didn't know is that they were all an experiment of what you could do in a public place. And that's been captured now in the Rutledge Handbook of Creative Placemaking. So the first one is create structure to assist, not limit. Set your vision for the success of the place, identify the mission or the reason, and then establish your core values that serve as this criteria and the guidance for creative content. Don't determine the end result in advance of the artist. Be authentic and distinct through ambition. Authentic means being true to your site and its heritage and character. Being distinctive means that you generate a new or celebrate an existing USP. Be ambitious, daring, surprising, inspirational, in accordance with your context, your resources, and telling your story. And never underestimate your audience. Set up stages, permissions, systems for collaboration. Begin partnerships before you need anything. Generate a positive relationship with the owners and managers of spaces to establish key contacts. Set up the communications protocol for partners. Develop a way of working that empowers stakeholders to take risks by respecting their fears and finding ways to mitigate the unnecessary risks. Use cultural professionals because they know how art is made as well as how it's presented. Develop relationships with cultural institutions and entities to build that trust. Seek presenting partners who bring diversity of artist, audience, and press. It all helps to expand your own. Don't forget to address your blind spots. Invite expertise. We all have them. Never assume anyone can do this on their own. So set up what's right for you. An advisory council, a curatorial committee, or selection committees, these will all round out your own knowledge. Art in public space is never about a single authorship. Surround yourself with those who can help. Your stakeholders, residents, staff, they all want to feel protected and respected. But through this work, people develop strongest bonds through a successful shared risk. Your stakeholders become allies beyond the life of just that project. There's always going to be a place for the glitch or the guerrilla movement in our media architecture. But for the placemaking or the mainstreaming or the cyborg institutions, we all need each other. We need it so that we can flex with funding and social trends. And the only way to generate a collective society is to behave like one. Thank you.
Hello. Now we're back to real life.
Thank you so much, Sherry. That was a really rich and generative talk. And thank you also for joining us now for this live discussion. So we're going to open things up to the audience for questions. You can either type things into the Q&A function in Zoom, or if you're willing, you can also join us in conversation. I believe Tanya and Vivian are helping us with this behind the scenes. I guess I have the privilege of asking the first question. And Sherry, one of the final things you ended on in the presentation is this really interesting thread around the idea of authenticity. Can you maybe just define for us again what that means? Because there was also, I think, a glitch in that moment in the video. Define for us what that means for you, how you kept it in mind at various stages, including the selection process, and also how one negotiates authenticity, perhaps, when there are so many stakeholders at the table.
Sure, and it also depends, how old your area is or how much history there is. You know, obviously, like, for example, I do quite a bit of work in the city of London, the oldest part of London right now. And so, you know, authentic is many, many centuries of authenticity as far as what might have happened there. And many people are going to have different ideas of what that is. I think what's crucial is that you can't expect every single project or artwork to be the symbol of authenticity. What it can do is take an aspect of authenticity. And it can even take an aspect of authenticity that many people didn't know about, you know, a previous history that had happened on the site, and through the work, you're able to uncover it. I think, you know, one of the things that was so important is that we were always thinking about seasons, a series, an annual program, and the larger long term of what we were trying to achieve. And one of the things that we looked for was the richness of the different stories that exists with the site. So it was never one project was the ultimate in hitting something authentic. It was looking at those different types of authenticities that are present. And you know, again, as I say, inviting expertise and others to be involved, you have the wonderful process of discourse then with people. And you have the ability, you know, it's through some of those discussions with selection committee members that you're challenged. And some of the thoughts that you might have had at first, you might not have been aware of other perspectives or other contexts that people hold. And there have been a few occasions in which, you know, we were sort of surprised by something that was an association or a visual association that we hadn't anticipated. And it was so thankful to have people telling you at the very earliest point when you're deciding about whether you're going to do a work or not, to have a variety of perspectives who challenge you on how is that authentic. But the other thing structurally is that's one of the reasons why we had five core values, you know, for Times Square. And a lot of times those core values or those principles represent the different qualities of authenticity. You know, so that's why we had in there, you know, transparent and conversational and boundary pushing, et cetera. It wasn't just one. And then each project didn't necessarily fulfill all five of those criteria every one time. But it is a helpful way for you if you're trying to judge between which works you want to prioritize. You can have a very objective conversation with art sector and non-art sector about, well, this one seems to hit three of the criteria or five of them. And if one is only hitting one, then you have the ability to say, okay, it's only hitting one, but does it do it in such a way, you know, that it's so innovative that it's worth it, or the timing of what's happening in the world really, really makes it worth it. But interrogating that and being able to answer that is what helps you when it goes out into the world, and the public will have different responses. Everybody may not like everything you do, but if you have a robust way in which you can explain to people why you chose the work and how it has that relationship, or how it has that relationship to authenticity, then you can stand strong, you know, and you can help protect those choices and also the creative choices.
Thank you. We have a hand up. Merrill, did you have a question? Not sure if Morale does. There's also a question that's written in from Suniti. I'm an architect fresh out of school. I want to start making large immersive art. Apart from learning the technology making, how does one grow and make connections and ensure that projects get audiences and clients who want to host it?
Oh, wow. I don't think there's one answer. I mean, it depends also, I think, on the city and the way that your networks work. But, you know, there are different organizations that are networks and umbrella organizations, and it's good to be part of those and those discussions. I often find it's through conversation that people then get excited about you and want to know more about your work. So asking very precise and unique questions. I also always encourage people, write to whomever you want to, but be specific. You know, we all have a lot of emails to get through, several social media platforms, Slack, you know, everything else. What is really enticing is when somebody writes to you and asks you something very specific, or says, I'd really love to talk to you about this. Because then you know someone's put some thought into it and they want to engage in a conversation, and you don't necessarily feel the responsibility of having to immediately proffer an opportunity. So I really do encourage people, you know, write to whomever you think is you know, you admire, and say, I love this, I'd really love to have a conversation with you, and make it short. Offer them, say, you know, even if it's 15 minutes, and either, you know, an online call, or I'd love to meet you and I'll buy you a coffee or something like that. The appeal of having a precise request is really important, but never hesitate. Always go forward to whomever you think you'd like to speak to and see what happens. And then just keep working. I think it's really important that in a day and age where we spend so much time on explaining how artists and creatives are a business and communicating, it's really important that you never stop losing the ethos behind the work that you're trying to create. And the best way to demonstrate how you think or how you feel or what your ethos is or your great thoughts are to continue to do that through work and of any sort of scale.
It seems like a very encouraging answer. I don't think there's any other questions. I have another one.
There are some, I think, in the chat as opposed to the Q&A part. But like Thomas says, what was the reason that the provocative installations from the 1980s with Jenny Holzer ended, and with Midnight Moment, the role of art became more relevant again? Yeah, so Jenny Holzer was just one artist that Jane Dickson actually curated during that time. And so Jane Dickson literally was hired to actually, she was an illustrator, and she was hired to set up the corporate content for One Times Square Spectacular. And in that, she realized that there were these gaps in the schedule. And so she was an artist. Her husband, Charlie Ahern, is an artist, and Charlie's twin brother, John, is an artist. And they were part of first the sort of the East Village scene. And then they moved to Times Square, and they moved to Times Square as parents with small children. And one of their small children grew up and became one of the curators who worked with me on an entire program called After Hours. Anyway, Jane was doing that from her paid position. Then when she wasn't working at One Times Square Spectacular, and also it was becoming quite time consuming, she approached Public Art Fund to see if they might take that on. And so that became Messages to the Public. And then there was a series of those pieces over, I forget how many years, maybe it was 9 years. Creative Time also founded a couple of relationships. They did the 59th minute, and then they did 44 and a half. And those were based on independent relationships with different signs and different sign holders. Performa was able to work with, it's slipping my mind now, Rutgers and NASDAQ screens, which are sort of paired as far as their programming. But honestly, it's getting to the sign holders, it's getting the right approach, it's getting the right suggestions. There's never been a shyness of artists wanting to access the space. But there is the just how do you find people, and then how do you put together the package to make it really easy for someone to say yes? What was the rationale behind it? Why would they do it? And of course, you know, for sign holders and property holders, they've got the most valuable real estate, you know, one of the most valuable real estates in the world. So whenever they give any time to anyone, they are establishing a precedent of who they might give time to in the future. So it was a very tricky project to put together. And, you know, I'll be honest, for the first year, we thought it might only last 3 months. And then we were really excited when it lasted 5 months. You know, then we got through, like I say, the Yoko Ono piece. And once we got through that, everybody started to realize just what this kind of quirky thinking can do and how you can really excite people and how there was so much international engagement and so much attention that it became very appealing. And I mean, you know, people talk about benchmarks, and one of them is the kind and the quantity of press. So there's an incredible publication, which I'm sure you've all read, which is called Sign of the Times. And it's a professional journal about sign, you know, for sign holders. And really, that's the only publication that ever put anything about the signs in print. It was very rare when there were articles, but usually the signs never got attention. But I was able to sort of wheel in, you know, the press books after our sort of second year and just slam these binders of press, you know, that we had got from the program to make them realize, you know, how worthwhile this investment was. And then as a result of that, like I say, being able to have sales material that was unbranded, the fact that artists were playing with the technology of their screen and showing it off actually raised the ambition of the commercial creative content that they were getting on the screens. And then of course it leads to people buying certain blocks of time that they wouldn't have, and people standing out there at hours so that the advertisers who were in those late night slots all of a sudden were getting a lot of attention. So yes, that's an abbreviated history.
Terry, one of the things that we had spoken earlier about, and I think it's a really fascinating kind of thread that you touch on, is this idea of risk, you know, your role in, like, facilitating or encourage risk taking on the part of artists. I think you also mentioned risk, the role of risk in the triangle. And I thought there was maybe an interesting correlation between risk and then what you talk about with regards to audience vulnerability and safety. So I just wondered if you could talk a little bit more about that, either as kind of separate things, risk and safety, or the ways that they also intersect.
You know, risk is important. I think one of the things I've really learned, and particularly working within a business improvement district where people are worried about real risk. I mean, one of the things that, you know, I'm a big pacifist, and one of the things I realized when I took over the job in Times Square is that there are like up to 3 genuine terrorist threats per day that everybody is dealing with and trying to mitigate. So the seriousness by which we would have to adhere to, like, not putting bags down, or, you know, not taking a performance just into a street, or things like that, I started to realize the importance of them. And one thing, the reason why I say that is because it's very important to also respect those who are dealing with risk on a regular basis, hear it, you know, and understand it. And by doing that, they then will respect you back and possibly look for more. So one thing that May and I were talking about in preparation for this was, you know, that I made 3 promises to the sign holders. One promise is that the work would make their screens, their real estate look good. I wouldn't put content up there that made it look like there was a problem with the billboard. 2 was thinking that I would do a diversity of work in terms of, you know, motion, different types of graphics, content going up and down, wide, you know, et cetera. We would play with everything creatively and do a full range of it to actually, again, create examples of what can be strong. But the third and possibly the most important element was to say, if for some reason there is a majority vote for yes for content, and there's only one screen or two who don't agree with that content for whatever reason, then they had the ability to bow out. And it was by giving that permission of being able to say no that meant that I think there were only like three occasions in 5.5 years that we had any signs that weren't participating. And so in that way, they could risk more. So as a result of that, and then seeing how things were developing, we were able to get to the point where we could put 6 months of content up in front, and we could actually propose some artist content that was incomplete and make a vote on it saying, okay, in theory, you know, we accept this. And as long as we receive it 2 months before the final work and it adheres to the comments or concerns that we have, we can approve it. Whereas before, we could only present absolutely finished work. Because again, you're talking about a public realm that is so visited. It's not just visited, but you know, there are cameras. There have been cameras on Times Square for a long time, these that are just sort of basic webcams to the world. I forget what they call it. And when I started, there were over 40,000 people at any one time who were looking at these cameras on this space. And by the time I left, it was up to like 85,000. You know, at any one time, there were people tuning in to see what was going on. So there is a high amount of visibility, people who can take pictures at inopportune moments, they can catch one little thing and they can turn it into an enormous, you know, campaign. So our approach was to respect the larger risks, to try and mitigate those ones that weren't necessary so that we could actually take more risk with the creative work. If you try and demand, you know, full autonomy in a public space, you'll end up with a lot of restrictions on the work. So, you know, it's being able to understand and respect all the different pressures that the stakeholders might have. And then, like you say, the other thing that I would tell artists is, it's not about what you can do and can't do. It was respect the audience. So when you thought about, you know, when you think about content, particularly when it's on a scale that it's 16 stories high, everything has a different meaning, you know? So nudity on 16 stories when people are underneath the naked body looking up the body has a very different meaning than if you were looking at it, you know, on a monitor in an art gallery. And so it's just thinking about how does that work resonate when you have all of those images surrounding on a massive scale? And does anybody who's standing in the middle of it feel vulnerable or attacked in some way by the content on the screen? Do you potentially offend the very audience that you're trying to draw in? And just by thinking about it that way, not telling the artist what that output looks like, but just reminding the artist of that, then they make the choices. And you know, that really took care of artists not censoring, but really thinking about it in a way that they could push boundaries and at the same time not put somebody in a vulnerable position when you're standing in the middle of up to 25,000 people at one time that, you know, you don't know.
Thank you. We have a question from Christy King. Thanks, Christy, for this question. So Christy writes, thanks, Sherry, for an enlightening presentation. I enjoyed learning about the history behind Midnight Moment and the various challenges faced with building a quote-unquote domination event. Given your experience and having seen events around the world, what would you like to see happen in this field in the future?
This is a good question. I'm very excited one reason why I'm very excited to come next week too is to be involved in a lot more of the seminars and everything in person and meet a lot of the practitioners. And that's also one of the things that's been great about being on the jury. I'm really interested in how we can have more interactive content. This is the scary thing in a public space, but also it's one of the most exciting things. And a lot of the infrastructure for the media architecture is barely being tapped. You know, so for example, in Piccadilly Lights in London, you know, there's, and pardon me because I'm not on the technical end, but there's actually the capability, you know, to sort of grab content off of the screen onto your phone. right? There's a way in which you can exchange things. And so I think it's going to be very exciting when we can find a way to have more playfulness with that, and where we can open up a space where we can try some interactive work. Because one thing that I've realized is people's work going in these very, very, expensive pieces of real estate give them such an incredible sense of validity. You know, to be able to tap into a part of the world that you feel like you have no access to is really exciting. And that's what's been going on and been a very exciting exchange, perhaps for artists. But what's even more exciting is the more that many people could take advantage of that. You know, so how do we find a safe way to allow this to be a portal in which we feel like we can actually place ourselves, you know, in real time in these contexts? You know, how might we be able to more responsively counter sort of fear-mongering statements about people or peoples and such by making those counter images present easily? How do you feel like you can actually take something from something, you know, that you feel like is taking from you? So I really look forward to understanding how there's much more of that interactivity and how it can happen in spaces that are very often considered to be only for the elite.
I think I meant to turn things over to Dave and Patrizio in the Toronto studio about now. So please join me again in thanking Sherry for this excellent session and for your generous answers. I think, anyway, the hope is to continue some of these conversations next week in person.
Yeah, thank you so much for letting me participate.
Thank you, Sherry. Thanks to the audience.
Okay, thank you, May, and thank you, Sherry. What an amazing presentation. It was everything I dreamed it would be and more. That's exactly what we had in mind as an executive committee when we were thinking about that theme of civic creative commercial. You know, who could we bring on to really talk about this from, you know, a point of great experience? And Sherry, your experience just like shone through there in terms of your understanding about how all of those things come together. And, you know, I'm glad that this isn't the end, that we're going to continue this conversation in a few different places. On Gather, of course, during the online days, but then of course in person where we can pick up on this. But, you know, so many great points. Respect the audience, I thought, was such a great point. A lot of times artists and designers, architects come in with lots of big ideas about, you know, what can we do? And I love how you shift it to that question, and that your role is so important in sort of preparing all of those different entities within that civic creative commercial matrix to talk to each other and merge and move towards not necessarily a common goal, but to have everyone's goals sort of fulfilled commonly, which I thought was great. So thank you so much for that.